Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of Session 6 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I would like to remind everyone present to switch your mobile phones to silent. The first item of business is to decide whether to take item 8 in private. Is the committee content to take this item in private? Yeah. Thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 2 this morning, we are taking an evidence session on the committee's inquiry into the use of the made affirmative procedure during the coronavirus pandemic. This is the first of two planned evidence sessions taking place this month before the committee takes evidence from the Scottish Government in January. Can I welcome to the meeting Dr. Ruth Fox from the Hansard Society, who is appearing remotely from London, and Maura Gross QC from the Faculty of Advocates, who joins us in the committee room. We're very grateful that you are both able to attend. So before we move on to others in the committee, I'd just like to start the questioning. And so I'd be grateful certainly from both witnesses just to have an understanding of any general views that you may have of the made affirmative procedure, such as the observations on the frequency of the use of the made affirmative procedure during the coronavirus pandemic as compared to the pre-pandemic. And I'll start with Ms. Ross, please.
All right, thank you. Thanks very much. I'd like, if I may, just to say a little bit about what I can and can't say on the basis of the experience that I bring that informs that. I'm here, obviously, on behalf of the Faculty of Advocates. For my own part, predominantly, my experience and expertise is in administrative and public law and parliamentary procedure. Is not normally considered in the context of legislation, of litigation rather. So I can't say that there's direct professional experience of these sorts of measures. But there are general principles relating to decision-making processes in general, about the way in which statute law is made, and importantly about the accessibility of law. Which all of these things are at the heart of public law in practice, which is what I do. So it may be that I can offer observations from an external, legally informed perspective that might assist. I should say as well that there have, as you'll be aware, there have been some cases in court where the courts have looked at the lawfulness of coronavirus regulations, in particular in relation to worship in churches and aspects of regulation in the hospitality industry. But these have not, at their core, looked at the process. I should say I'm aware of these cases, but I haven't been directly involved. And speaking as I do on behalf of faculty, I can't make any comment on the political aspects, and I can't really say in any one case, any individual regulation, whether it was justified or not, either as a matter of policy or procedure. With that introduction, I think it's important to say that for faculty, for lawyers, there are general issues of principle and practice. I'll just say very briefly what I consider those to be chiefly, and they are to do with, first and foremost, the rule of law and the place of parliamentary democracy in the way in which law is made, with clarity in legislation, with the risk of complexity in legislation, which might come about in this way, through accessibility of law, the visibility of law to society at large, but also to lawyers, and questions about whether it's possible to define or to be more specific about urgency. I think these are probably the critical areas that will be of concern to the committee. I'm happy to expand on any of those, but that's probably sufficient, and I'm happy to answer any questions which follow.
Okay, no, thank you for that opening. Can I ask you just on the issue of the urgency, which clearly is the area that this committee will be looking at in more depth, can you provide your thoughts in terms of the urgency issue? Because clearly, pre-pandemic, there were very few made affirmatives were made, yes. But obviously since the pandemic, it's been a totally different situation.
Yes, yes. Well, of course, I mean, the as I understand it, the provisions that you're looking at, the regulations which have been made, have chiefly been made under one of two statutes, is the Public Health Scotland Act 2008 and the UK the Coronavirus Act 2020. And both of these have very similar provisions, you'll be aware of these, of course, which refer to circumstances where the ministers consider it to be urgent. I'm glossing that slightly. And it would be tempting to think that you could narrow that down, that you could, well, you could either narrow it down to say urgency definitely means X, or it definitely means Y, and it doesn't mean Z or A or B or C. Tempting though that might be, it's likely to be impossible to do that in any meaningful way in practice. You have to be able to anticipate, not necessarily all eventualities, but there has to be room for the unforeseen. And also things change. You have to have the flexibility to allow decisions to be made that respond to changing circumstances. Urgency might mean one thing in week one, and it might mean something else in week two. And so you have to allow for that to be developed. One of the things that occurred to me as I was thinking about this is whether there are any useful parallels in looking at other circumstances where decision makers are constrained by having to by urgency and by having to look at what urgent means. And I'm not seeking to say that this is a direct parallel or an obvious analogy, but in public procurement regulation, which obliges contracting authorities, generally public authorities, to follow really strict rules before they can award public contracts. And I pause there to say that, of course, the awarding of public contracts is an issue in the coronavirus context anyway, but I'm leaving that to one side. In routine public procurement, you have to follow certain steps. There has to be a timetable. It's all very highly regulated. But there are exceptions that allow contracting authorities to not to apply that and to award a contract without advertising. And provisions made for that as a matter of EU law and in domestic legislation in the regulations that apply in Scotland. And the provision there is where, but only if it is strictly necessary for reasons of extreme urgency brought about by events unforeseeable. And so there's an example of where regulation has gone a bit further and has said that it has to be unforeseeable, that it has to be strictly necessary, and it has to be extreme. I'm not suggesting, I'm not advocating that is a model to follow, but it's as well to be aware that in other circumstances, efforts have been made by the legislator to define what urgency means. And it's important also to understand that the courts, when they have had to construe that, have taken really quite a strict line on testing government or contracting authorities in actually really what were the circumstances. So I mention that to be aware of, as I say, not to say there's a model and adopt it. But I think in general terms, you are left with the term urgency within the framework, and it's a matter for how it's applied.
Okay, no, thank you, Ms. Ross. Dr. Fox.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Perhaps I could just also set the context that the Handsaw Society has been monitoring all statutory instruments laid before the Westminster Parliament since the start of the 2017 session. So my remarks are almost universally about the approach to made affirmatives taken at Westminster and what sort of lessons are transferable from that experience. So I haven't been monitoring instruments before the Scottish Parliament, and I'm not as familiar with the Scottish Parliament's procedures as I am obviously with those at Westminster. In terms of the approach of the UK government to made affirmatives, I mean, it's certainly true that the use of the procedure was relatively rare until the last few years. And we've certainly seen an increase in the use of the procedure, not just because of COVID-19, but also because of Brexit. So there were quite a number of provisions in Brexit-related legislation that went through the Westminster Parliament that included the similar provision as we see in the Public Health Act, that was replicated in other legislation, including the EU Withdrawal Act and the Customs and Cross-Border Trade Act, and also the Future Relationship Act that went through between Christmas and New Year last year. So there are a number of provisions for the made affirmative procedure now on the statute book. Prior to Brexit, and COVID, you tended to see the made affirmative procedure used in relation to a lot of financial or tax related provisions. In evidence to the House of Lords Secondary Legislation Scrutiny Committee earlier this year, the First Parliamentary Council, the head of the Office of Parliamentary Council in Whitehall, said that prior to the COVID legislation, the only legislation she was aware of having the procedure was either civil contingencies legislation or a lot of indirect tax legislation. And certainly we see a lot of the use of the made affirmative procedure and an urgency in relation, for example, to sanctions, the application of sanctions regulations, partly in terms of urgency due to the need to control capital flight, the need to introduce provisions very quickly in relation to high risk countries and so on. And then obviously in terms of taxation and customs issues. So we've never seen the use, obviously, of the made affirmative procedure in the Public Health Act on this kind of scale. And the question about whether or not it was necessary for it to be used in all circumstances, obviously highly debatable. I think in terms of the sheer volume, to give some context to the debate, certainly in terms of the use of the procedure at Westminster, since the start of the 2017 session, there have been 221 made affirmative instruments. So that's just over 5.5% of all instruments laid before the Westminster Parliament. But if you look at specific sessions, the height of the COVID crisis, the height of the provisions for Brexit, at times it was reaching 10% or even in the short session around prorogation and prior to the 2019 election, it reached nearly 17% of the share of all instruments laid before the Parliament. So it certainly has increased, and you definitely see peaks in the use of it in relation to the height of the pandemic, obviously, and Brexit delivery.
Okay. Thank you for that, Dr. Fox. I think it would be useful for anyone watching this just to make people aware of the figures in Scotland. Under the Public Health Scotland Act, there have been 63 made affirmatives, and the Coronavirus Act 2020, 61. In total, there's been 132 in Scotland between the 20th of March 2020 and the 2nd of December 2021. On the issue of the, I mean, it's difficult to do a direct comparison, which I think we will all agree with. So every single instrument goes through this committee in the Scottish Parliament, whereas that's not the case in Westminster. So I think also just I wanted to make people aware of that, anyone who's watching, because it's an important point for people to recognise. So just on the, once again, on the issue of the instruments that have been made using the affirmative procedure, I'll go to Dr. Fox first of all. Do you have any particular thoughts on, notwithstanding the numbers that you indicated, and also your focus is clearly about Westminster and not so much about here, but do you have any kind of thoughts on the nature of the instruments that are used? Do you think that in terms of the increase in number onto the public health, and you indicated there at one point 17% of instruments in Westminster were made affirmative. Do you think that the nature of instruments being used in terms of the policy areas are accurate, correct, or potentially maybe just overbearing? Dr. Fox?
Question of urgency. I mean, there is no constraint on the minister's use of the power. He or she only has to declare that they consider the matter urgent, and therefore necessarily have to use the power. And if you look at a number of the regulations during the pandemic, particularly last summer, as we were sort of emerging from lockdown, there were particular concerns at Westminster, and I think these were replicated also in relation to the actions of the devolved governments, that some of the regulations had been discussed and debated or the policy direction had been discussed and debated at some length through media press conferences, through debates in the Parliament, but the regulations emerged very late on, shortly before they were brought into effect, and often published quite late, sometimes as little as half an hour before they came into force. So the whole question of whether they were urgent, given how long they had been discussed and had clearly the clear direction of policy was there. Was it necessary for them to be published as late as they were? Was it not possible for the instruments to have been brought in through the draft affirmative procedure, albeit with a commitment on the part of the Parliament to expedite its procedures in relation to the draft affirmative procedure, so that the scrutiny could take place before the instruments came into effect? I think you see throughout a real concern about the absence of substantive supporting documentation, supporting information, inadequate explanatory memorandums, a lack of impact assessments and an evidence base for the policy. Now, that, to what extent that's partly a product of the developing nature of policy within the pandemic, and to what extent it's about the way in which ministers have been able, for reasons of political convenience and administrative convenience, to push these things to the wire, and to get away, if you like, without producing that information and without doing that substantive policy work, because they've got this option to resort to the made affirmative procedure, is obviously hotly debated. And certainly at Westminster, there is, as I know there is with your committee, a concern that that ministers are using that power rather than doing some of the policy work to provide that information when the regulations are brought forward.
Thank you, Dr. Fox. Ms. Ross, same question, please.
Yes, I think there's a particular point which Dr. Fox made a moment ago, which I'd like to develop a little further, and that's to do with the question whether giving information in general is a substitute for parliamentary procedure, whether because it might be suggested that this is, that so long as you communicate and so long as government tells everybody what it's thinking of doing, that's enough, that as long as you've got a clear public message which tells everybody in simple terms, then that satisfies the requirement of certainty. I would suggest that's not a substitute for proper parliamentary procedure. You can only have a message that is properly clear if the law that underpins it is clear. A clear message has to have a grounding in law, and law has to have a grounding in proper process. And you can't just get over that by putting out statements saying what's going to happen. So if it's suggested that it's enough to meet the requirements, for example, of transparency and accessibility for government just to say, here's what we're thinking of doing in terms of future regulation, here's what we're planning. Well, I mean, of course, communication is a good thing. Nobody would say that shouldn't be said in public. And statements have to allow also for the possibility that things might change. But in both of the statutes that you're looking at here, the default is affirmative procedure. And urgency, made affirmative procedure, is the exception. But the default in public health regulations of the kind that would be needed, the default is that there should be affirmative procedure. So if there's enough time to discuss options in public and to canvass views, then there is likely to be enough time to introduce legislation in the conventional way. And it's a mistake. People can accept that communication is a good thing, but that shouldn't be allowed to turn into a substitute for proper process. And I think all of that then, as I said at the beginning, that there are really important things to do with accessibility of legislation, of law, and all of that is connected to those things. I'm happy to say a bit more about that, but also to respond to your questions.
Sure, no problem. Thank you. I mean, just on that then, it then touches upon kind of the final point that I'd like to explore, and that's on the issue of the consistency of the instruments that are brought forward. And the, clearly, every single piece of legislation that comes forward, there will be some individuals who will look at it and criticise it, no matter what it says, and others who won't do that, and they'll maybe look at it from a different perspective. But in terms of the made affirmatives that have been brought forward, do you have any thoughts or any considerations on how that legislation actually has been drafted? Is it something that are you aware of any, or do you have any opinion on any that potentially you feel as if have been not drafted well and have then created a situation of kind of law that's maybe difficult to understand? Or do you is your opinion that well, the majority, if not all, have actually been easily read and easily understood?
Well, you won't be surprised that I can't say that I have been through every instrument that has come before this committee, and I'm not able to offer a view on individual items of drafting. But what I can offer is are some observations about the tendency of accelerated procedures to result in risks. I can't say that the courts have had to look at some of the instruments that have been made, and it's part of the day-to-day work of lawyers that you scrutinise and read carefully small parts of legislation, primary and secondary legislation. But perhaps it's more important for these purposes just to step back and look at some of the general tendencies. Clarity is absolutely fundamental to good legislation. Legislation has to be clear and capable of being understood and applied consistently. And legislation that is made in a hurry is unlikely, in general terms, to be of the same quality as legislation to which great thought has been given and preparation has been undertaken. I don't want to make any criticism of those who draft legislation. It's a tremendous skill, and to be able to do it at speed accurately is a very valuable skill indeed. And where circumstances are pressing, a great deal of respect is due to those who work under those in those circumstances. But it's inevitable that there's room for mistakes to be made. Bringing legislation into force without the opportunity to give it proper scrutiny beforehand, that takes away at least an opportunity for checks. But I want to be clear that this is not just about technical defects. It's not about, you know, checking punctuation. I pause to say that the technical side of legislation actually is really, really important. Defects in structure, expression, and so forth can have significant consequences. But it's not just about technical drafting. It's also about policy, because it's only if you actually understand the policy and you've tested the policy by asking questions about it that you can be satisfied that any piece of legislation, any instrument, secondary legislation, is actually necessary, that it achieves what it says it is there to achieve. It's only if you get to grips with all of that, and you can only get to grips with all of that if you've had some opportunity to ask the questions. So whether that's for this committee or whether it's, as I understand it, for a policy committee to deal with that, there has to be an opportunity to do that. Now, you can't say it has to be the maximum possible opportunity, but that does have to be there. And the second thing in general terms is to do with complexity and the repeated making of instruments on the same subject, because the more instruments are made and the more they add to or qualify or revoke in whole or in part or update existing regulations, then the more complex the whole picture becomes. So if you make use of the made affirmative procedure repeatedly, then the risk is there of accumulating rapidly changing regulation, and that becomes confusing. And I'd say it's particularly important, these problems become particularly acute where you're looking at criminal sanctions, where you have the risk of lack of certainty about whether you're breaking the law or not. And that matters not just for individuals, it matters for lawyers providing advice on the legislation. And it's a matter of fairness to the individual citizen, it's fairness to the police and prosecutors, defence and the courts, for all of these, in the context of criminal sanctions, for all of these people to fulfil their functions, there has to be clarity about it. And if you've got repeated cycles of changing this or that, then that's not conducive to accessibility. It's also, in other areas, it's also an issue for those, for example, whose businesses are affected by emergency legislation. And where you have the made affirmative approach taken, then there's at least scope for those who are affected by it to lose the opportunity to make preparations and to organise their affairs in advance, anticipating what might happen. Sudden changes, especially if the consequences take a while to understand, are quite unhelpful. Now, of course, as Dr. Fox has said, there will be circumstances with tax legislation and so forth where that's absolutely fine, and everybody understands that. But in this much more unforeseen environment, the ability to plan and to understand the law in advance is really, really important.
Thank you for that. Dr. Fox.
Yeah, I would agree with much of that. I mean, I think just in terms of the point that Mora Grass was making about the complexity of the legislation as a result of frequent amendment and the sort of the layering of SIs on top of each other, I mean, certainly at Westminster that has been a significant problem. And I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a policy sector expert, so I can't comment on the quality of the legal drafting or the policy direction itself. But I think it's a strong hint when you see very frequent amendment very soon after the instrument has been laid. It's a hint that there is a problem with the drafting. So, for example, back last summer, we saw statutory sick pay regulations were amended twice within 4 days. We had the health protection restrictions, the localised restrictions, affecting the areas of Blackburn and Bradford, for example, were amended twice in 12 hours. We had face covering regulations were amended by three different statutory instruments made in 2 days, last September 2020, sorry. We saw last autumn the COVID restrictions amending the main lockdown number two regulation. The drafters had remembered to make provision for Remembrance Sunday when it came to listing permitted exemptions to the restrictions on gatherings, but had forgotten about Armistice Day itself and had to go through in terms of laying a new instrument subject to the made affirmative procedure, go through that whole process again in order to make that amendment. So, you know, one problem clearly in the way that the made affirmative works is that the pressure on urgency, the pushing through of this legislation very quickly, the lack of upstream scrutiny by, in Westminster, the technical policy, the technical legal check done by the Joint Committee on Statutory Instruments, in your Parliament, done by your committee, is missing. And therefore those drafting problems get through and you then have to either amend the regulations, which adds to the complexity, or you have to revoke them. Certainly at Westminster, we then had the bizarre situation where, because debate to approve the instruments were not happening very quickly in summer 2020, and there was a long delay because of parliamentary recesses, we had the bizarre situation where MPs were voting to approve instruments that had already been amended. Therefore the debates and, you know, didn't make an awful lot of sense. So you then had that problem emerge in the scrutiny process at the end of the approval process as a result of these upstream drafting problems.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Dr. Fox. I'm going to hand over to Craig Coy. Craig.
Thank you, and good morning, Ms. Ross and Dr. Fox. I just wanted to perhaps just backtrack a little bit and just wondering out loud that if there is some contradiction or tension between the balance for the necessity for emergency legislation to be of significant importance and to be urgent, and the fact that it then goes on to get the least amount of scrutiny, or certainly a limited amount of scrutiny. And one example, I think perhaps, Ms. Ross, you may have been alluding to or not. Recently, we obviously had the COVID passport regulations came before this committee. And as a new member of this committee, my concern was that the regulation may have been exactly as it should be framed, but the policy that it gave effect to was certainly deficient in that the passports didn't prove that the person who had presented the passport was in fact the same person to whom the passport was issued. So there was an element of possible impersonation there, and also that once we introduced lateral flow tests, it didn't prove that the person had actually had a negative test, just simply that they declared themselves negative. They may or may not have had that test. So I suppose what I'm wanting to get at here is, how do we manage this tension between the debate that goes on and then, if in effect, the absence of scrutiny that seems to take place both around the detail of the made affirmative instruments, but also, more importantly, the policies that it brings effect to? How do we manage that tension between the debate and then the lack of legislation, of scrutiny when the legislation comes forward?
Is that directed? The original, your starting point was to identify the tension. That arises because scrutiny takes time. Not necessarily lots of time, but it takes time. And by definition, almost, an urgent measure is something which must be done right away. So there is necessarily a tension between the amount of time that can be spent in the process thinking about something and discussing it, and the need to do something immediately which stops people behaving in a particular way or obliges people to behave in a particular way. The question about the debate then comes in, if you're adding that into the mix and saying, well, if there's time for that, then why not follow the process? I think, bluntly, the answer is that's a political issue for you as politicians to discuss with government. As to the place of public discussion as opposed to or in addition to what happens in Parliament. Having said that, I wonder whether if you are looking to explore ways in which you as a committee deal with made affirmative instruments where there has been some discussion. It may not matter whether there's been discussion or not. One thing that it's important to bear in mind is, I suppose, and I'm not seeking to tell you how to do your jobs, but I think it's important to remember that anybody who is looking at something which is already in force, effectively a fait accompli, will approach it in a particular way. And that way is likely to be different to the way in which the person applying the scrutiny approaches legislation which is prospective. So if you have two instruments, one of which has already been made, you will look at it, you are likely to be looking at it in a different way to that which will come into force in 28 days' time or whenever. There may be a particular something to look at in checking how you scrutinise something made under the made affirmative procedure. Do you give it the same amount of time? Do you approach it in a way that is based on your being prepared to say, actually, no? These, I think, are questions. I'm putting the questions back to you. There might be something in your own processes about what it is you do when you're looking at made affirmative. Do you just accept it, or to what extent do you test it? That might not be a long-term answer, but how you deal with that might inform where you go next.
Would you foresee, if we carried on in these circumstances, that there would be more recourse to the courts as a result of continued application of made affirmative? Would that be one of the routes that, for example, industry would look to utilise if Parliament isn't effectively scrutinising and holding the executive to account for those laws?
In the first place, I'm going to be very cautious and say it would depend entirely on the circumstances of any particular measure and the circumstances of anybody who sought to challenge that. It might be surprising if the sole complaint were about the way in which it had been made. Mm. Much more likely, if somebody were seeking to challenge legislation, it would be on the substance of what the policy and what was sought to be brought forward or what had been put in place. That's much more likely to exercise those who are affected by specific legislation. But if it has been made in a way which it were suggested that was objectionable, then that might be something that alongside a challenge to the substance might be brought before the courts. I mean, typically nobody wants to go to court just to make a point about procedure. It has to achieve something. There has to be an end result. So it would be perhaps unlikely, but I couldn't possibly say that the thought wouldn't occur to anybody in the future. It might well do.
And Dr. Fox, just in respect of perhaps the way we look at these instruments between Holyrood and Westminster, in the case in point in relation to the COVID passport regulation, we could only look at the instrument in terms of making sure that it was framed in a way that was sound. We couldn't really dig deeper into the policy, which I think certainly some members of the committee thought was defective and deficient. How does that differ at Westminster? Would those that are looking at the instrument also look into the policy, or are they just again looking at the way in which the legislation is framed?
Yes, so the procedures in the House of Commons and the House of Lords are different. So a made affirmative instrument going through the Commons would be subject to consideration by a general committee comprised of 17 MPs, usually in what's called a delegated legislation committee. They'd have a 90-minute debate, they'd have the instrument, and they'd have the supporting documentation. But there's no, it's not a committee like a select committee or a subject committee. It doesn't have a secretariat. There's no policy research notes or briefing material. There's no legal advice provided. So MPs do their scrutiny in a really quite difficult circumstances, given the technical nature of the regulations that they have to look at. Well, some of these regulations, and the vaccination regulations are an example, the debate will not take place in the committee with a small number of MPs to be then approved by a motion in the House later. It will go to a full debate in the chamber in which all MPs can participate, but again, subject to 90-minute restriction under standing orders, unless that business motion is moved to extend that. So they are reliant upon advice and information on drafting and on policy matters that is provided by either the House of Commons Library at speed or is provided through external organisations, civil society organisations and campaign groups. The House of Lords is rather different because they have a committee system, the Secondary Legislation Scrutiny Committee, which looks at all instruments and reports on them. And they look at it from a policy perspective. So they look at, if you like, the merits of the regulations, and they draw them to the attention of the House. And then you have a joint committee of both houses called the Joint Committee on Statutory Instruments that will look at the technical legal drafting matters, similar to your committee's remit, and that will report on things like the virus and drafting irregularities and so on. Now, in the House of Commons, they will consider or can consider instruments without reference to the Joint Committee's report. So they will sometimes debate and approve the instrument before the Joint Committee has reported. In the House of Lords, they operate a scrutiny reserve. So that committee has to have reported before they will schedule a debate and an approval motion. The problem with the made affirmative procedure is that because of the time constraints, and that particularly the desire to lend approval as quickly as possible after the made affirmative has been laid and come into effect. There's been pressure to hold the debates quickly, not at the end of the 28-day period. And that means that the scrutiny reserve in the Lords has had to be lifted. So, in effect, the House of both Houses have been scrutinising these instruments without access to the committee reports. And certainly on the vaccination regulations, there was a lot of criticism of ministers in terms of the lack of supporting information and evidence base, the inadequate impact assessments. The Secondary Legislation Scrutiny Committee hauled the minister in to give evidence before its committee about the lack of supporting information and the inadequacies of the impact assessment. But whilst that committee session was going on, the House of Commons was debating and approving it. But there's a problem at Westminster in terms of the inadequacies of scrutiny in normal times in the House of Commons, which is exacerbated in circumstances of urgency. And then you've got the problem of the bicameral scrutiny and the fact that much of the committee-based examination of the detail of both the policy and the legal aspects is done by their committees, and to which the House of Commons doesn't have access.
Do you see merit or benefit, Dr. Fox, in giving the committee or the group of parliamentarians who look at the regulation as we do, also having some authority to probe the policy and the impact of the policy to see whether or not it's not just the regulation, the instrument that's well drafted, but to make sure that it leads to good outcomes when it's actually applied in policy terms? Is the merit of bringing those two functions together within the same group?
There may be. I mean, sometimes the nature of the drafting, it seems to me, how it's drafted will impact upon policy, and what you're trying to achieve in policy terms will affect the drafting. So it always has seemed a bit of an odd demarcation at times, but that's certainly been the way Westminster has handled it for many years. I think one of the issues, particularly with the made affirmative procedure through the pandemic, is that what in effect the system allows is it the way the powers are framed inherently favours the government. They can get their legislation through quickly, they can achieve their policy objectives, but Parliament gets nothing in terms of compensatory scrutiny provisions. So one of the issues is whether it is with either the legal drafting issues or whether it's with the policy merit questions. Should there be some kind of bespoke procedure for these kinds of instruments that enables either one committee acting jointly or committees acting separately to have a second bite at the cherry, as it were, so that for a period of time, if the instrument is enforced for a period of time, that you'd be able to come back after the approval motion has been granted, with those committees having the time to look in more detail at the instruments, both on legal and policy matters, and then to report back. Now, that would require some kind of sunset provision, perhaps, to enable that to happen. And that's sort of the direction, I think, of thinking at Westminster, that certainly both the Secondary Legislation Scrutiny Committee and the Delegated Powers Committee, which looks at the powers in all bills that are laid before the Lords, that's the direction of travel I think they're looking at for the future.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Craig. Graeme Simpson.
Thanks very much, convener, and thank you both for coming. It's been very interesting so far. Dr. Fox, I've just got to praise you for some of your work so far, including your book, Devil is in the Detail, which I was thinking of putting on my Christmas card list, but knowing my family, I'll probably end up having to buy it myself, but looks like an absolute bargain, so I'll be rushing out to get that. But Morag Ross, you mentioned earlier, you made a very interesting point, I thought a number of interesting points, but one was how do we as parliamentarians deal with stuff. If it's been put through under a made affirmative, it's already law, and then we're scrutinising it, as opposed to something that's not law already. And I think you're absolutely right. There is a tendency for parliamentarians to actually look at stuff that's already law and say, well, it's done. We'll just nod it through. And actually, sometimes the law has already been overtaken, or there's been amendments laid, it's null and void. So you just think, well, I'm not going to bother with this. And that's not the way it should be. And that's the purpose of this this mini inquiry, is to look at that. In the interests of time, I won't go over some of the ground. I'm keen to explore solutions to how we improve things. So in terms of debates, when the Scottish Parliament debates regulations, it will go through. So it will go through this committee, and we've got a remit. Then it will go, whatever it is, it will go to a policy committee. And in terms of this inquiry, mostly the COVID committee. And then it will go to the full parliament. And when it gets to the full parliament, the opportunity for most of us as MSPs to debate that regulation is extremely limited. You'll have a minister, you may have one member of each party taking part. And there's some really, really important stuff going through. Craig Hoy has mentioned vaccine passports. But the debate as such is extremely limited. So I'm just wondering whether there's something there. Maybe this is a question for Ruth Fox. Should we... I mean, you, Ruth, mentioned that in Westminster they get a 90-minute debate. We don't get that. So do you think there's something there for us to look at in Scotland?
Well, I wouldn't take the Westminster model as a model for anything in relation to delegated legislation, because I think even in normal times, the scrutiny is really very, very poor. And the reality, I think, is for legislators, and you've alluded to it, if members can't amend and don't reject an instrument, then the scrutiny process is very difficult. And having an effect and being able to influence the regulations is difficult. And as a consequence, we see certainly this at Westminster. I can't speak to how the approach of members in the Scottish Parliament is, but certainly at Westminster, you know, members want to get that 90-minute debate over as quickly as possible. They have 90 minutes, but in reality, the average is just under half an hour. Sometimes the debates can last just a few minutes. There is a problem with the relationship between, you know, the power that is set out in legislation, perhaps decades ago, as we see with the 1984 Act, and the content of the regulation that's laid today. And the scrutiny process doesn't match up with the importance or otherwise of the regulation that's before members. There needs to be at Westminster an overhaul of the entire system, not just in relation to made affirmatives, but as part of a much bigger process of reforming how members of both houses scrutinise instruments. Now, I'm very glad you enjoyed our book. I can send members of the committee free copies. We have quite a few in our office still. From our perspective, the Hands-On Society has recently launched a review of delegated legislation to look at these issues, precisely because the processes are so inadequate. So there may be things that Westminster does differently to the Scottish Parliament, and that might appear to be an improvement on perhaps what you feel you have available. But certainly there is huge dissatisfaction now among many members across parties and across both houses with the way delegated legislation generally is being scrutinised. So I would be very wary of thinking that Westminster offers much in terms of lessons for the future.
Morag?
Yes, I think that you're looking for solutions and looking ahead, and of course you'll need to be giving thought, as I'm sure you are, to what happens when legislation, the coronavirus legislation in force for a particular purpose, comes to its natural conclusion, and what you put in place in the longer term after that. And I think there's one particular word of caution, which is in how you treat the experience of legislating over the past 18 months, 2 years, and to what extent you come to see that as exceptional, you collectively as politicians as a whole see that as truly exceptional. And I think the important, actually starting this inquiry and stepping back and saying, are we getting it right, and how can we do it better, is an absolutely critical part of addressing that question, and asking for this committee to ask, is the way we've done it, is that going to be a change which sets us on a course for the future, or do we see this as ring-fenced, time-limited, only for coronavirus? And there might be, when things have changed in response to an emergency, and where that emergency, however understood, continues, then there is a risk that things become permanent. And if they're going to become permanent, you have to decide that they're going to become permanent, and not just allow it to drift into permanence by inertia. And I think that is a real risk. You can see an analogy with some, I suppose, the substance of some policy matters. I mean, for example, on measures that were only ever intended to be in place, or which people thought would only be in place for a few weeks or perhaps a couple of months. So, and I'm making no comment on the benefits or otherwise of mask wearing or school closing. But when we first started thinking about masks, we thought, well, maybe for a short time. When we thought about school closures, maybe for a short time. But as things go on, that becomes something to which people are habituated. And the analogy that I'm seeking to draw is that if you start to use provisions that are put in place on an emergency basis, and those start to become routine, as time passes, the routine becomes quite attractive, and it becomes quite easy and quite straightforward. And it can be a real effort to say, remember how it used to be when we regarded these as exceptional. So the step of asking these questions in the context of this inquiry and giving advanced thought now to what future legislation with enabling powers should look like is a really important part of answering that question. The risk otherwise is the ground just shifts under your feet. And if you don't notice, 2, 3, 4 more years down the line, then it's a much harder step to take to say, actually, what does good scrutiny in a normal environment look like?
Yeah, I'll be quick, convener, because I realise we're up against the clock. So I'm going to roll two questions into one here, again on the theme of what do we do now? So, I mean, I'm really frustrated at the use of the made affirmative procedure. I think it's been overused in both parliaments. It's been overused. And my view is that ministers, when bringing forward these regulations, should have to justify why something is urgent or an emergency. I think they should have to come to a committee, or at least write to a committee, and make the case. And also, picking up on the House of Lords report on this subject, I think it would be a good idea that every piece of legislation made under the made affirmative procedure should be subject to a sunset provision. And so there's two things there. Should the government have to make the case that it's urgent or not? Should that be subject to a vote in a committee or the parliament? And should these regulations be subject to a sunset provision, and if so, what should that be? What length should it be? I'll start with Morag on this one.
I think it is certainly worth looking at having a sunset clause as a sunset provision as a default. and that is different from what already exists in the made affirmative procedure with the in the case of these particular primary pieces of primary legislation, the 28-day provision. It's different from that. And there may be a benefit in just making it standard that it will fall after a certain period. And I think that has been the case in at least some of the instruments that you've looked at made under the primary legislation here, that they do have that provision in place. You have to guard against, of course, just the rolling extension, the movable feast. I think it was described in court in the case involving churches where it did just get continued. Should there have to be a justification? Inevitably, there is a level of trust that has to be observed. That Parliament and government have a mutual relationship of trust, and it should be assumed that there is a basis for advancing something on an emergency or an urgent basis. And it would be important for a requirement for a justification not just to become a token that you just have to tick a box. It would be unfortunate. It would just be a waste of time, frankly, if you reduced it to that. Should that relationship of trust be formalised to make it a requirement? I think that probably is a political matter. Would it add to the clarity, visibility, accessibility of it? I'm not sure, but it might be a helpful check in circumstances where, as Dr. Fox says, a lot of the power lies with government.
And Dr. Fox?
In terms of the obligation to explain and justify urgency, yes. I mean, certainly we advocated that at the time the European Union Withdrawal Act was going through the Westminster Parliament in 2017, 2018, because there is an urgency provision in that as well. And there are some examples on the statute book where the use of the made affirmative procedure has been hemmed in a little bit. Though the Misuse of Drugs Act 1971, which has a power to reclassify drugs, a minister has to consult an advisory council before using the procedure and has to explain the position of the advisory council on the policy decision that they're proposing. Now, that's a slightly different use of the made affirmative procedure because it's not necessarily on grounds of urgency, but it does apply to the procedure. Perhaps more relevant one is the Legal Aid Sentencing and Punishment of Offenders Act 2012, where the Lord Chancellor, if he or she considers it desirable for regulations to come into force without delay, they have to set out an urgency statement explaining why. And the instrument can't come into force before the instrument and the regulations and the urgency statements are laid before Parliament. Now, you know, for the pandemic, you might have to have slightly different approach. And clearly, you don't want to reduce it to a tick box exercise. But I think having something that requires the minister to do more than simply put a line in an explanatory memorandum which says, I think this is urgent, raises the bar a little in terms of thinking within the department, both at a civil service and drafters level, and also at a ministerial level. Now, whether that would be in the form of a written statement, an oral statement to the House, which would raise the bar even further, because of course you're then taking up valuable parliamentary time, and the business managers won't want that. So there'll be a competing pressure bearing down on ministers. Is this really necessary? Of course, one wants to assume that in these circumstances, there's a basis for the urgency. But to give you one example, reverting back to the face covering regulations, in summer of 2020, when these were debated in a delegated legislation committee in the House of Commons in I think it was September 2020, the minister was asked what the basis was for urgency. And she said, I don't know. I'll have to go back and check. So, you know, you'd think that that would be a sort of a basic point that, that would be covered off in the briefing. But, you know, that was sort of a very good example of a made affirmative, use of the made affirmative procedure that was clearly not necessary and not urgent in those circumstances, given the way that, you know, the timings had worked.
With Dr. Fox's views in relation to that, and perhaps to add that one is entitled to expect that when the ministers consider that that is reasonable and that it's qualified by reasonableness, there may be circumstances in which you have to make that express. And I think that the sorts of examples that are given illustrate why that's important.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Graham. Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. Now, I just want to thank both of our guests today for the fact that they've covered just about everything that I was going to ask. However, in fact, only just a moment ago, part of it. But just for the sake of re-emphasis of the rationale behind this committee's role in Parliament, because scrutiny is for the provision of clarity of the message in law and enhancement of this for us all, can I just once again ask if there are any possible transparency implications around the use of the made affirmative procedure? Are there dangers that it's used just in order to press home a political point of view or whatever? I don't know if that's putting you on the spot by asking you that, but is there a danger of that and therefore a necessity that scrutiny is very much before it goes through the parliamentary debate, it takes place within committees. Does that make sense to you?
Yes. I think to answer that, it's maybe important to go right back to the beginning and to first principles about the public good that exists in having not just law which is clearly drafted, or which hangs together from a technical perspective, or even law which meets policy objectives in a satisfactory and useful way. You could do all of that with inadequate scrutiny. It would be possible sometimes just to get everything right without scrutiny. But that's not what the rule of law properly means. That for society to be governed by law, that law has to be properly made. It doesn't just have to be well prepared and able to be justified by government. It actually has to happen, and it has to come before Parliament. That might sometimes be seen as a formality. It might sometimes be seen as a bit dull, and it might sometimes be seen as actually not very political at all. And there might not actually be a whole lot of controversial debate, but it is absolutely essential that everybody, and you know, this is speaking as a lawyer, but it's far more important than that, that everybody has confidence that law has been made in a way which follows proper process, which gives an opportunity, which might be limited with certainly with negative procedure, but even with affirmative procedure, it might be limited. But nevertheless, there is the opportunity for elected representatives, part of a democracy, to fulfil their function and contribute to the process of making law. And if I can offer this thought, and I'm not sure you were asking about the political implications, and I want to be careful as to how far I can go. But if I can offer this analogy about, as I see, or a possible way of looking at made affirmative procedure, that it's a little bit like strong medicine. Strong medicine is valuable in some circumstances, and indeed in some circumstances it can make the difference between life and death. And you can see the analogy if you have a life and death situation, being able to change the rules immediately overnight might be essential. But like strong medicine, it has to be handled with great care and only used when it is genuinely needed. Perhaps more importantly, it goes back to a point made earlier, and this is perhaps where some of the political considerations come in. some medicine, strong medicine, can become addictive. And if it's used too much over time, it loses its efficacy. And it can become easy to use. And those who find that it solves a problem can decide that it's going to solve that problem, and the next one, even though they don't actually demand that sort of treatment. And if I can, I'm reluctant to stretch the analogy too far, but there are side effects. And one of the negative side effects is the diminution of respect for the role of Parliament. And I think all politicians, whether they are in government or at working in the way that you do, have to be aware of the potency of what the made affirmative procedure actually is and does, so that when you're looking at how it's deployed in the future, you treat it with the care that it needs.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you. I don't know if Dr. Fox wants to add anything to that at all.
But for Parliament, there's a statutory process for the laying of instruments before Parliament, for the publication process, and that's there for a reason in relation to transparency and public notice, public access, and public understanding. And clearly, when you are in a situation, as we have been during the pandemic, where instruments are being laid 30 minutes before they come into force, and that the made affirmative procedure facilitates that, then that's clearly extremely difficult in terms of, parliamentarians, let alone the public, being able to understand what the legal obligations are, and what the implications of them are. And for example, we saw, social distancing rules were imposed at Westminster in a change announced on the 9th of September of 2020, but the regulations weren't actually published until 30 minutes before they came into force on the 13th of September. Certainly one of the lessons of this pandemic is that the difficulties of communication at a governmental level for several days beforehand about what the regulations are going to do, but nobody actually having access to the legal text know explicitly what they say. And I think one of the difficulties that has to be looked at by parliamentarians is that government, particularly in Westminster, makes the case that these issues are being debated ad nauseum, that they're providing time for debate on COVID each week, on different aspects of the pandemic, that there's lots of ministerial appearances before committees. But actual legislative scrutiny, the scrutiny of the technical detail and the policy merits in the context of all that supporting information that you would ideally have before you, is a very different form of scrutiny to the more generic debate you have about policy direction in a general debate in the chamber on a fairly general motion. And I think that's one of the things that we really need to drive home, that Parliament needs bespoke procedures or that kind of detailed technical scrutiny in an emergency, or when ministers want to use the urgent procedure in the future.
It's very helpful, and thank you both very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. And Paul Sweeney. You're on mute, Paul.
Oh, and to understand someone. Oh.
Paul, can you repeat the question, please?
Can you hear me all right now, convener?
We can now, yes.
Oh, very good. Sorry about that. I'd say it's been a really interesting discourse to follow. Thanks very much for your insights. If I could ask Ms. Ross, just in general, perhaps a view about, from a historical perspective as much as anything else, do you think that the made affirmative procedure's use and increasing use represents a general shift away from legislative power from the Parliament towards the executive? Is that a sort of valid observation to make?
Well, clearly the numbers that have been given earlier in this meeting and are known to you indicate that that's the case, that there has been a very definite shift whether that can be attributed absolutely entirely to coronavirus or whether it says something about other trends, I think is something that you need to explore. Coronavirus is the obvious explanation, whether there is something else going on and whether this fits into a wider pattern. And it's been really interesting, I think, to hear from Dr. Fox about how this fits into the wider perspective at Westminster is something to be aware of. It would seem you can't just take it as coronavirus in isolation.
I suppose a helpful insight. I think just controlling for the pandemic, Dr. Fox obviously have a perspective on the study they've done from 2017 in the House of Commons. What would your general impression be from a more historical perspective? Is this a long running or a long term trajectory of the erosion of parliamentary power relative to the executive that has to be something that will concern to members of parliament in both House of Commons and at the Scottish Parliament?
Yes, I mean, one of the features of the debate about delegated legislation generally, not just the made affirmative procedure, but how statutory instruments are laid and scrutinised generally. People were having these exact same debates in the 1930s. There were, you know, books being published about government by diktat, about the use of emergency provisions, setting a precedent for the future in the aftermath of the Second World War. There was a committee on ministerial powers in the early 1930s, the Donoghue Committee. They were having almost exactly these same debates. So history would suggest that the concern about the concentration of legislative power with the executive and the shift of influence away from Parliament, and the balance of power between the institutions has been a long-running sore. Whether it has gotten worse in recent years, the suggestion is yes, because what you're seeing, I think over the last probably 25 to 30 years, is skeleton bills, the greater use of skeleton bills with broad powers, with policy ill-defined, giving ministers considerable scope for the way in which they choose to exercise those powers through regulations at a later date. And the sheer breadth of the powers and the volume of them obviously gives ministers more power to exercise in the future. So certainly the perspective at Westminster is that whilst the general trend continues, it has sharpened, it's gotten worse, the volume of it is greater than it used to be. You have to see it, I think, in recent years, though, within the context of the extraordinary political developments of Brexit and the pandemic, and the combination of the two, coupled at Westminster with a situation where you have a government now that has a significant majority, and that can therefore sort of, you know, effectively ram through the House of Commons quite often what it wants. And therefore, you know, whilst there are a group of Conservative backbenchers who are unhappy about these scrutiny issues, generally speaking, they've got the numbers, particularly if the opposition is supporting these pandemic measures. They've generally got the measures, the numbers to drive through the regulations.
Well, that's a really interesting insight, I suppose, the perils of elective dictatorship. I think that's an interesting point, perhaps to hold in perspective with the Scottish Parliament, because obviously the parliamentary arithmetic is somewhat different, and the scope for potentially scrutinising this and holding the government and the executive's feet to the fire on inadequate provision and on the face of bills and making sure that they aren't just skeletons, as you put it, would be a worthwhile thing to consider going forward. I just think it was helpful just to get that explicitly stated, I think, for the purposes of what we're trying to achieve here. So thank you both for that. Just very kind of non-technical take, if you like. I think just to sum up, is there anything further that you might want to add that we haven't considered about the made performative procedure and how we might want to look at the scrutiny process for it, for made affirmatives? I'll open that up to both of you. Feel free to jump in.
I think from my perspective, I'm happy that I've answered your questions. I hope I'm happy to, if there are further questions, I'm happy to deal with them, but I don't have anything to add to what I've provided already. Thank you.
Dr. Fox?
I think there's perhaps just one issue to throw in at the end to perhaps consider, and that is that there isn't, as we've discussed, a bespoke procedure either at Westminster or in your Parliament in Edinburgh for urgent situations, for the use of the made affirmative procedure under the Public Health Act or similar similar provisions. But there is, at UK level, the Civil Contingencies Act 2004, which I think gives a sense of what Parliament expected in an emergency in terms of scrutiny. Now, those provisions have not been used, and there's quite, you know, a lot of debate about why the government chose to bring in the Coronavirus Act and chose to use the Public Health Act rather than to use the Civil Contingencies Act. But that Act provides for an emergency and considerable breadth of powers. All regulations must be laid before Parliament as soon as reasonably practicable. Parliament has to approve them within 7 days. It has to approve the renewal of them every 30 days. Parliament can, in some circumstances, amend the regulations, and Parliament can be recalled if it's not sitting. So I think it's worth looking at that as the sort of top end of Parliament's prior expectations for how scrutiny might work in an emergency, and comparing it with where we have ended up during the pandemic on an ongoing basis, and thinking about how those provisions might have applied and what impact they might have had during the pandemic, if that had been available to members as a scrutiny model instead, or whether that too would need tweaking into some form of bespoke model that was for use in urgency, but not for use necessarily using the powers in the civil contingencies legislation.
Thank you for that, Dr. Fox, and thank you for your questions, Paul. Just before we do close this session, I just got one final question for our two witnesses. And it's also, we have the affirmative procedure, we have the made affirmative procedure. And also with the affirmative, there's the 40 days period. Would a procedure in between that be useful in the current circumstances that we face, particularly regarding the COVID regulations that are coming through? Ms. Ross?
I'm not sure what do you mean by in between? Do you mean a some sort of accelerated procedure or with different time limits?
It's something with different time limits.
Between?
If there was a new procedure to be created, would that, do you think there's something that could be created that could be beneficial to enable this committee and Parliament to undertake the scrutiny work that obviously that's been discussed this morning?
Well, there's always room for testing. If you're looking at future primary legislation, which would seek to draw on the experiences of what is going on and has gone on in the last months, then there's always room for striking, drawing the line in a slightly different place. And I'm particularly struck by Dr. Fox's example a minute or two ago about the civil contingencies legislation, older legislation, which does set out perhaps more exacting requirements of emergency legislation broadly expressed. So if it's in between, potentially yes, you might have different options according to the level of urgency. I think there would have to be a word of caution that, and it comes from observations made just about complexity, that if you're going to introduce grades of expedition according to the level of urgency, you'd need to be very clear about it. I think rather than multiple stages, it's important to be clear about what is realistic and what is the what can you do to make it very clear that exceptional circumstances justified on their terms case by case are what you expect.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Ross. And Dr. Fox. Dr. Fox, I think there's an issue with your sound.
Okay, can you hear me?
We can now, yes, thank you.
I'm afraid I've lost all sound on the system.
Okay.
Okay, I feel like I'm afraid I lost what Morag Ross was saying earlier, so apologies if anything I'm going to say duplicates or you wanted to ask a slightly different question. In terms of, I think we were asking about the possibility of a bespoke or some kind of accelerated procedure. I think there's two aspects to it to consider. The first is the question of democratic accountability and wanting to look at and approve the instruments as soon as possible after they come into force and not waiting necessarily as long as 28 days. The problem with that, and we've seen that at Westminster where commitment was made to ministers last autumn under pressure from the government's backbenchers who were unhappy about the length of time it was taking for debates to be scheduled. They agreed to schedule debates as soon after important national regulations were brought in. The problem is you are then debating instruments within 1 or 2 days after they've been published. Now, of course, you can debate them, but it's quite difficult to do a full kind of assessment and scrutinise them in detail, and you lose the committee scrutiny process from that. So the members are in a sense scrutinising, debating them without access to the important work of your committee, to the important work of the committees in the House of Lords, for example, at Westminster. That kind of scrutiny needs time. So it may almost be worth thinking about a bespoke procedure which has two aspects to it. Yes, if the government wants to bring the regulation in, it can be debated and approved fairly quickly, but a provision of being able to do that is that there is an opportunity, some form of sunset on the regulation, so that members can come back and debate again in some form, and possibly approve again the continuation in force of the regulations once they have access to the technical scrutiny work that's been done by the relevant committees. So in a sense you get two bites of the cherry, but you get the democratic accountability dealt with early, and then the more detailed scrutiny can be looked at slightly later with a little bit the advantage of time for that. If that's felt appropriate. Now, clearly, ministers, again, won't like that because that creates an element of uncertainty about whether the regulations are going to remain in force. And obviously, it takes up more time. But again, if the objective is to put some pressure on ministers about whether or not they really need to use these procedures, that may be beneficial from Parliament's perspective in terms of the balance of power between the institutions.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Dr. Fox. And just before we do suspend, I'd like to thank both Maura Gross QC and Dr. Ruth Fox for your helpful evidence this morning. And I'm sure that the committee will extend their appreciation to you both for that. Also, if there are any additional questions that the committee may have, we will write to you after the session, if that's okay.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much to you both. And with that, I'll briefly suspend this meeting. Under agenda item number 3, we're considering an instrument laid under the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. The committee is considering if the appropriate scrutiny procedure and the appropriate category has been applied to. So SSI 2021-432 is the Animal Products Transitional Import Conditions Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2021. This instrument has been laid under the negative procedure and is considered by the Scottish Government to be of low significance. Is the committee content with the appropriate scrutiny procedure has been applied to this instrument? Yeah, okay, thank you. Members will note that the instrument removes the requirements for products of animal origin and animal byproducts to be accompanied by health certificates. This differs from the previous instruments that have been postponed, that have postponed the implementation of border control measures. Given that this approach appears to constitute a policy choice, does the committee agree that the categorisation should be of medium rather than low significance?
Yes.
Okay. And I think also with some of the policy areas that are highlighted in this instrument, does the committee agree that we should write to the relevant committee to highlight our thoughts on these?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Under agenda item number 4, we're considering instruments subject to the made affirmative procedure. No issues have been raised on SSIs 2021-425, 440, 441 and 443. Is the committee content with these instruments?
Yes.
In relation to SSI 2021-425, that's the Health Protection, Coronavirus, International Travel and Operator Liability Scotland Amendment number 7 regulations in 2021, Does the committee wish to highlight the Scottish Government's response to the committee's questions regarding eligible vaccinated arrival status to consider from a policy perspective?
Yes.
And note that this SSI addresses an issue identified by the committee at its meeting on the 9th of November 2021 in relation to 4D of SSI 2021-359. Thank you. Under agenda item number 5, we're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft Town and Country Planning Short-Term Let Control Areas Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022 and the relayed draft Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 Licensing of Short-Term Lets Order 2022. Is the committee content with these instruments? Also, does the committee wish to welcome that the relayed draft Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 Licensing of Short-Term Lets Order 2022 addresses issues reported by the Session 5 Committee at its meeting on the 12th of January 2021 in respect of the draft Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 Licensing of Short-Term Lets Order 2021? Under agenda item number 6, we're considering instruments subject to the negative procedure. An issue has been raised on SSI 2021-438, that's the Ethical Standards and Public Life, etc., Scotland Act 2000, Register of Interests, Amendment number 2, Regulations 2021. This instrument amends the Ethical Standards and Public Life, etc., Scotland Act 2000, Register of Interests, Regulations 2003, in light of changes made to the Code of Conduct for councillors and the Model Code of Conduct for members of devolved public bodies. SSI 2021-397, the Ethical Standards and Public Life, etc., Scotland Act 2000, Register of Interests, Amendment Regulations 2021, was laid before Parliament on the 8th of November 2021 and was considered by the committee at its meeting on the 23rd of November. The committee resolved to report the instrument under Reporting Ground I, due to a failure in the instrument to make provision for all registrable interests as set out in the revised Model Code contrary to the policy intention. That instrument would have come into force on the 8th of December. The current instrument was laid on the 25th of November 2021 and came into force on the 7th of December 2021 to rectify the errors in SSI 397 and make further provision. It is in breach of Section 28.2 of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010, which requires that instruments subject to the negative procedure are laid at least 28 days before they come into force, not counting recess periods of more than 4 days. Does the committee agree to report the instrument under reporting ground J for failure to late in accordance with laying requirements under the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010?
Yes.
Also, is the committee content with the explanation provided by the Scottish Government for breach of the requirement in section 28.2 of the 2010 Act? Finally, does the committee wish to welcome that the Scottish Government laid the instrument timorously to rectify an error previously identified by the committee at its meeting on the 23rd of November 2021? Yes. Also, under this agenda item, no points have been raised on SSIs 2021, 431, 432 and 442. Is the committee content with these instruments? Under agenda item number 7, we are considering instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2021 428. Is the committee content with this instrument?
Yes.
And with that, I'll move the committee into private. Thank you.